Note. Charles Scribner Jr. and I worked together preparing this book for publication from Ernest's original manuscript. Beyond the routine chores of correcting spelling and punctuation, we made some cuts in the manuscript, I feeling that Ernest would surely have made them himself. The book is all Ernest's. We have added nothing to it. Mary Hemingway. Simon & Schuster Audio presents Islands in the Stream by Ernest Hemingway. Read by Bruce Greenwood.
Bimini. Chapter 1. The house was built on the highest part of the narrow tongue of land between the harbor and the open sea. It had lasted through three hurricanes, and it was built solid as a ship. It was shaded by tall coconut palms that were bent by the trade wind, and on the ocean side you could walk out of the door and down the bluff across the white sand and into the Gulf Stream. The water of the stream was usually a dark blue when you looked out at it when there was no wind. But when you walked out into it, there was just the green light of the water over that flowery white sand, and you could see the shadow of any big fish a long time before he could ever come in close to the beach. It was a safe and fine place to bathe in the day, but it was no place to swim at night. At night, the sharks came in close to the beach, hunting in the edge of the stream, and from the upper porch of the house on quiet nights, you could hear the splashing of the fish they hunted, and if you went down to the beach, you could see the phosphorescent wakes they made in the water. At night, the sharks had no fear, and everything else feared them. But in the day, they stayed out, away from the clear white sand, and if they did come in, you could see their shadows a long way away. A man named Thomas Hudson, who was a good painter, lived there in that house, and worked there and on the island the greater part of the year. After one has lived in those latitudes long enough, the changes of the seasons become as important there as anywhere else, and Thomas Hudson, who loved the island, did not want to miss any spring nor summer, nor any fall or winter. Sometimes the summers were too hot when the wind dropped in August, or when the trade winds sometimes failed in June and July. Hurricanes, too, might come in September and October, and even in early November, and there could be freak tropical storms any time from June on. But the true hurricane months have fine weather when there are no storms. Thomas Hudson had studied tropical storms for many years, and he could tell from the sky when there was a tropical disturbance long before his barometer showed its presence. He knew how to plot storms and the precautions that should be taken against them. He knew, too, what it was to live through a hurricane with the other people of the island, and the bond that the hurricane made between all people who had been through it. He also knew that hurricanes could be so bad that nothing could live through them. He always thought, though, that if there ever was one that bad, he would like to be there for it and go with the house if she went. The house felt almost as much like a ship as a house. Placed there to ride out storms, it was built into the island as though it were a part of it. But you saw the sea from all the windows, and there was good cross ventilation so that you slept cool on the hottest nights. The house was painted white to be cool in the summer, and it could be seen from a long way out in the Gulf Stream. It was the highest thing on the island except for the long planting of tall casuarina trees that were the first thing you saw as you raised the island out of the sea. Soon after you saw the dark blur of casuarina trees above the line of the sea, you would see the white bulk of the house. Then, as you came closer, you raised the whole length of the island with the coconut palms, the clapboarded houses, the white line of the beach, and the green of the South Island stretching beyond it. Thomas Hudson never saw the house there on that island, but that the sight of her made him happy. He always thought of the house as her, exactly as he would have thought of a ship. In the winter, when the northers blew and it was really cold, the house was warm and comfortable because it had the only fireplace on the island. It was a big, open fireplace, and Thomas Hudson burned driftwood in it. He had a big pile of driftwood stacked against the south wall of the house. It was whitened by the sun and sand-scoured by the wind, and he would become fond of different pieces so that he would hate to burn them. But there was always more driftwood along the beach after the big storms, and he found it was fun to burn even the pieces he was fond of. He knew the sea would sculpt more, and on a cold night he would sit in the big chair in front of the fire, reading by the lamp that stood on the heavy plank table, and look up while he was reading to hear the northwester blowing outside and the crashing of the surf, and watch the great bleached pieces of driftwood burning. Sometimes he'd put the lamp out and lie on the rug on the floor and watch the edges of color that the sea salt and the sand and the wood made in the flame as they burned. On the floor, his eyes were even with the line of the burning wood, and he could see the line of the flame when it left the wood, and it made him both sad and happy. All wood that burned affected him in this way, but burning driftwood did something to him that he could not define. He thought that it was probably wrong to burn it when he was so fond of it, but he felt no guilt about it. As he lay on the floor, he felt under the wind, although really, the wind whipped at the lower corners of the house and at the lowest grass on the island and into the roots of the seagrass and the cockleburrs and into the sand itself. On the floor, he could feel the pounding of the surf, the way he remembered feeling the firing of heavy guns when he had lain on the earth close by some battery a long time ago when he had been a boy. The fireplace was a great thing in winter, and through all the other months he looked at it with affection and thought how it would be when winter came again. Winter was the best of all seasons on the island, and he looked forward to it through all the rest of the year. Chapter 2. Winter was over, and spring was nearly gone when Thomas Hudson's boys came to the island that year. It had been arranged for the three of them to meet in New York, to come down together on the train, and then fly over from the mainland. There had been the usual difficulties with the mother of two of the boys. She had planned a European trip, saying nothing, of course, to the boys' father when she planned it, and she wanted the boys for the summer. He could have them for the Christmas holidays, after Christmas, of course. Christmas itself would be spent with her. Thomas Hudson was familiar with the pattern by now, and finally there was the usual compromise. The two younger boys would come to the island to visit their father for 5 weeks, and then leave to sail from New York student class on a French line boat to join their mother in Paris, where she would have bought a few necessary clothes. They would be in the charge of their older brother, young Tom, on the trip. Young Tom would then join his mother, who was making a picture in the south of France. Young Tom's mother had not asked for him and would have liked him to be at the island with his father, but she would love to see him, and it was a fair compromise with the unmalleable decision of the other boy's mother. She was a delightful and charming woman who had never altered a plan that she had made in her life. Her plans were always made in secret, like those of a good general, and they were as rigidly enforced. A compromise might be effected, but never a basic change in a plan, whether that plan was conceived in a sleepless night or on an angry morning or on a gin-aided evening. A plan was a plan, and a decision was truly a decision, and knowing all this and having been well educated in the usages of divorce, Thomas Hudson was happy that a compromise had been made and that the children were coming for 5 weeks. If 5 weeks is what we get, he thought, that is what we draw. 5 weeks is a good long time to be with people that you love and would wish to be with always. But why did I ever leave Tom's mother in the first place? You better not think about that, he told himself. That is one thing you had better not think about. And these are fine children that you got from the other one. Very strange and very complicated, and you know how many of their good qualities come from her. She's a fine woman, and you never should have left her either. Then he said to himself, yes, I had to. But he did not worry much about any of it. He had long ago ceased to worry, and he had exercised guilt with work insofar as he could, and all he cared about now was that the boys were coming over and that they should have a good summer. Then he would go back to work. He had been able to replace almost everything except the children with work and the steady, normal working life he had built on the island. He believed he had made something there that would last and that would hold him. Now, when he was lonesome for Paris, he would remember Paris instead of going there. He did the same thing with all of Europe and much of Asia and of Africa. He remembered what Renoir had said when they told him that Gauguin had gone to Tahiti to paint. Why does he have to spend so much money to go so far away to paint when one paints so well here at the Batignolles? It was better in French. Quand on peint si bien au Batignolles. And Thomas Hudson thought of the island as his quartier, and he was settled in it, and knew his neighbors, and worked as hard as he had ever worked in Paris when young Tom had been a baby. Sometimes he would leave the island to fish off Cuba.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.